Hello again, I'm Greg Anderson. You know, it's really not that often that I talk with a musical legend during a pandemic, in my own home, in fact. Well, today is the day. Singer, songwriter, and legend, Livingston Taylor. That's today's takeaway. I can't tell you how excited I am for what is happening in my home right now. I am talking with a legend, Livingston Taylor from Martha's Vineyard. Livingston, how are you?
Greg, I am so well, and I'm so pleased to be with you this afternoon. Thank you so much for taking time to talk with me.
Of course. I have to tell you the context of what we're doing and as this pandemic began to choke us, and in March we were all realizing that this was, you know, going to affect us for a long time. I knew that many industries were being impacted. We knew restaurants. We knew, everything was being impacted. But I was fascinated with what is being impacted that we might not necessarily automatically think about. Mm-hmm. And my first thought was you. My first thought was, I want to reach out to Livingston for two reasons.
Yeah.
One, your life has been interrupted as it relates to performing on stage and perhaps teaching, and you have done some social media on Facebook, which is really terrific. So there's a major shift that you've had, but also I love listening to you talk. I love your interviews, and when you are sharing your observations on any topic, your family, your life, your upbringing, your music, I just enjoy hearing you think. So with a pandemic, your perspective, I reached out to you first, and I wanted to just put that into context for you so you know exactly why I was reaching out to you. It is an honor.
I'm delighted, and what thought can I give you?
Well, I'm interested in first of all, how is everybody feeling? Everybody in the family okay?
You're safe? To ask, and James as well, Kate as well. James is out in Montana these days, and he's hunkered in Montana with his family. My sister Kate is here on Martha's Vineyard Island. My little brother Hugh just came back, was in the Bahamas where he winters. He runs a restaurant and an inn, and in the winter he is in the Bahamas. And so he's back from that to sort of face the music here in the States. And yeah. So, but all are well, all the family is well, and thank you for asking.
Yeah, well, I know you got a big family. Tell me what the vineyard is like. My wife and I, Jenna, she and I like to go down there typically in the off season, but
yeah.
I can't imagine what life is like in the vineyard.
I think that it's the same all over. And it's one of the things that's really interested me about COVID-19 is that, as is the case for human beings, one of the things that I've thought about recently is about intelligence and what intelligence actually means. And intelligence, to me, is really pattern recognition. And what happens is that when we run into patterns that we don't understand, it makes us fearful. And so what happens with COVID-19 is that it sweeps across our planet, and it's a viral intrusion that we don't understand, and what we're doing now is we're getting our heads wrapped around it. We're figuring out what it does, what it doesn't do, who it kills, who it maims, who it injures, how it spread. And as we figure these things out, then we'll be willing to assume the accompanying risk of living with COVID-19. Mm. But that doesn't happen overnight. Yeah. And as we gather information, so I personally, I love with prudence and care, of course, but I love watching the world open up again, watching that experiment. How do we feel when we open up? Are we scared when we walk into a restaurant? Do we feel okay? Wait a minute, it's flared up again. We need to back off a little. So where can we move forward? Where do we need to back off? One of the things I very strongly feel, Greg, is that, not that it doesn't impact young people, but statistically, it clearly impacts people with compromised health issues, mm-hmm. and old age, of which at the age of 69, and I'm an easy putt to 70, I'm in that category. Yeah. But young people, they do need to get out and be with one another.
Exactly. Let me ask you this. We're always looking at silver linings,
yes.
In any tough situation that we're in. I have noticed within my own family, there is a new sense of connectedness. We are finding ways that, frankly, we should have known all along that we can communicate more. We can have dinner at the table and not run around like crazy. Have you seen a change? You have two siblings on the island with you and other people. Has this social isolation, has this changed the way you and your family communicate?
In my case, because I'm not living with my siblings, probably not. Again, we all have more time because none of us are working. All of us have stunning quantities of free time. And free time is interesting. Free time allows you to go in different directions, allows your mind to wander.
How has, on the topic of working, how has your work been interrupted in terms of your tour dates and your schedule? How has your life changed?
I went from having an absolutely full schedule, as did my brother James.
Yeah.
And my little brother, our little brother Hugh, owns a restaurant in an inn. And the three of us went from being fully employed to nothing, zero. It's a radical change. Yeah. Now, we are personally fine because the universe has been so generous that we're not abused by this, yeah. meaning we have enough excess in our lives to withstand this for a while, not forever.
Yeah.
But this is serious, no, I'm big on getting the world moving again.
Yeah, when you're a man that, from my being a fan of yours for so many years, and especially doing some research for this discussion, you're a man that is, you're on the move. You are a professor. You are not just a stage performer, but you are a storyteller. You engage with people. I'm assuming your house is pretty quiet compared to, playing at a 500 people in a room. How have you adjusted to this going from 60 to zero?
And it's fine. my mind is active and it wakes up and I'm filled with ideas. And also when I become fearful, when I become anxious about these unexpected changes, I forgive myself for being fearful when I wake up at 3:30 in the morning, you know, bolt upright, as we all do in these times, just bam. I think it's okay. It's okay to wake bolt upright. It's okay to be depressed. It's okay to be sad. It's okay to ache and to have fear. Now, if it's incapacitating you, if you can't, if it's putting you in jeopardy, if it's making you suicidal, if it's making it so you can't get off a couch for days, if it's making you drink a great deal or drug a great deal, then that's serious and that needs to be addressed. But if you need to take a day and lay on the couch and cry like a baby and watch reruns of Andy Griffith, what the heck? That's okay. That's okay.
How did you know I did that yesterday? Let me ask you this.
I got it. You know, it's tough out there.
Are you, is this shift in our world, is it generating any creativity out of you? Are you writing songs? Are you?
No. I mean, you know, I play a little. But much of what I do is in anticipation of taking it to my beautiful audience. And in the fact that I'm not taking it to my audience means that my audience gives me direction. When I'm writing and playing, I'm thinking about my audience all the time. And given the fact that they're not around, I'm not writing that much. What I'm doing is I'm being still and waiting for that engine of hope to tell me where to go. Yeah. It's a depression. The stillness of depression is a very good thing. It keeps you from moving in a panic. You want to just be sad and depressed. And again, with the caveat of if you're suicidal or something, that's no.
Right. But of course,
it is really okay to just sit in a chair and wait for that engine of hope to reignite. Not to worry, it will.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. Facebook, you have a very robust presence on Facebook.
Yes.
Tell me, and you always have, this was even prior to this social isolation, and you are literally going from, I think this is what I said in the email to you, it's you're going from performing to an audience on the stage to performing to an audience from your living room.
Yes.
But you are so engaging. There is a connection between you and your audience that I don't know how to describe it. And it transcends into social media, in my opinion. What is that connection?
But let me be very clear about my social media. My social media is Julie Webb runs my social media presence. Brittany Bethune, who's one of my managers, she and Julie really run this stuff. And I have input to it, but I always use a filter. I took about 2 months, a couple of years ago, and was directly involved in my social media without these filters. And I'm telling you, it was a disaster. I am. Social media, well done, needs a filter. You need somebody to say, as my mind sprinkles off, it used to be that you would write that angry letter, right? Put a stamp on it, get ready to mail it the next, you had to wait till the next day to mail it. And you wake up that morning and you'd say, God, I'll just burn this stamp. You know, let me see if I can get the stamp off and put it on another letter.
Save it.
But I don't want to send this.
Yeah.
This notion of being able to express without filter is ultimately not a very good idea.
Yeah.
But yourself a favor. When you feel like saying it,
don't
wait 24 hours.
I'm 51 years old. I have never learned that lesson. It is a tough one. It is a tough one. But you do have that engagement with your audiences. It's as if you can see faces while you're alone looking at a little black box sitting in front of you. How do you do
I envision my audience. I see them. I love my audience. I need them. As I say to my students all the time, your audience isn't your problem. They're your salvation.
Yeah.
And when I'm in the presence of my audience, I am saved. I am free.
Wow. 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 You mentioned your students. That documentary, by the way, Livingston Taylor, Life is Good. Man, I love that. I loved it. It gave a great insight into the relationship between you and your students. And I'm an Emerson College alum.
Yeah.
So we've always had Berkeley down the street from us and with great admiration. And how are you doing with that, not being in front of your students? I'm not sure what your schedule would have normally been.
Well, I teach one day a week normally. I used to teach 2 days a week, but I've reduced it down to one in the last couple of years. But the fact is that higher education was already in trouble. It had gotten too expensive. It had gotten too complicated, too cumbersome. Asking beautiful young people to go into debt, to go to college. No. One of the fallouts from this COVID pandemic is going to be a lot of colleges go by the wayside.
Yeah.
Because people are going to be able to find information without writing those checks. And so this is a very interesting time, Greg.
Yeah.
No question.
Are you in touch with your students?
No, not terribly much. As we closed down, my class just didn't lend well to online. We did a bit of it, but some of my students I'm well in touch with. I don't have a close personal relationship with my students. I love them, but I am not their friend.
Yeah,
I'm their teacher,
yeah.
And that's a. I learn from them. They teach me a great deal, but I'm not there to eat pizza with them or to socialize with them.
Right.
I like being with them. I like watching them, but I don't want to be one of their peers.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm a big fan of you know, Carolina Day, that era of music, your early 70s music. I love your latest as well. Do you still play that on stage, or the old oldies but goodies?
A little bit. Occasionally I dip in, you know, happy was country until one day we found that cheating folks was easier than plowing daddy's grounds. He left his farm in Ohio, bound for Chicago town. Crossed Big Jim and turned his back, and the bullet laid him down. And as he lay there dying, he said, "Will I see my Ohio?" In my reply, I lied a bit and said I did not know. In my reply, I lied a bit and said I did not know.
Nice. Wow. Love that.
Yeah. It's funny because I was thinking about that song this morning, Greg. How much I liked that one.
Yeah, that is fantastic. Do you find yourself, like, what is on an average day, does Livingston Taylor just pick up the guitar and
sing
a ballad or two?
I've been doing a television show on Facebook on Tuesdays yesterday at 4:00. And I chose 4 so people in Europe could see me as well.
Excellent.
So I wrote myself a theme song for my show. Ready?
I'd love to hear it.
It's the Livingston Taylor Show. It's the Livingston Taylor Show. You never know where it's gonna go. It's the Livingston Taylor, Livingston Taylor, Livingston Taylor Show.
Love it.
Today on the Livingston Taylor Show, special guests brought to you by, you know, that.
Yeah. Love that. Yeah. You know, years ago, you did a commercial, the bed for cable is on. It was for a cable company.
Who knows? Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
I mean, it's.
Well, and again, I went through a time when I did a lot of commercial work, and I was very thankful for it. I love making music, and you know, it's not like I'm doing commercials for hand grenades. You know, it's for cable, and it's you know, I'm not doing commercials for nuclear weapons. You know,
right, exactly.
Uranium 235. 13 pounds it will blow everything up. I'm not doing songs about
you're
39 or 235.
There is an old video of you and your 4 siblings.
Yes.
On the NBC Tomorrow Show.
Singing, yes, with Tom Snyder. Yeah.
Yes, singing right. Shower the People.
You can run, but you cannot hide. This is widely known. What you plan to do with your foolish pride when you're all by yourself alone? once you tell somebody the way that you feel, you can feel it beginning to ease. I guess it's true what they say about the squeaky wheel. That man's always getting the grease. Better to shower
the people you love with love.
Humping up the shoulder.
The way that you feel.
Everybody thinks I'm gonna work out fine. If you only will. But I like to say to you. If you want it.
Take me to, I have seen that video so many times. I find it's family, it's you guys having fun.
Mm-hmm.
Take me to that time when all five of you, and I know your brother Alex is not with us anymore, but
yeah.
What did that feel like, either that night or just you guys all performing?
Well, we're a very close family. Feel the loss of our brother Alex, which was now 30 years ago, but just coming up on 30 years. And we feel that loss still acutely, miss him a great deal. That said, we're a close family. We love each other and take a lot of solace in the time that we spend together.
Yeah.
And those are wonderful memories for us.
Yeah.
Hard to get them to happen on a regular basis, but really very special for all of us.
So when you guys are at a wedding.
Yeah.
Do the singers in the group from Ben and Sally and
yep.
James and you and Kate, do y'all pick up guitars and is there singing that naturally happens?
I think that there's a one of the things that's important to remember is that when James and I or our sister Kate. And the three of us are the active performers. When we get on stage, it is well thought out. It is very, very rehearsed and disciplined.
Yeah.
The the patter along with it is relaxed and comfortable and easy, but it is not casual. And I don't casually make music, and I know James doesn't casually make music. It is very methodical, very thought out. So that notion of sort of picking up guitars and playing, yes, we do it, but not as much as you would think. Yeah. And that's because, when I learn a song, for example, it takes me, Greg, literally years to learn how to play a song properly.
Really?
And, oh yeah. And I write it and then I have to learn it. And it takes a long time to learn these things.
So you wrote a song, Boatman.
Yeah.
That one of my favorite songs. You wrote that. James performed that.
Yes.
How long did that take you to write? And
Songs take, I love it when somebody comes up to me and says, I wrote this song in 20 minutes. And I think to myself quietly, apparently. songs are hard to write. It requires every single note, word, chord are touched, smoothed, flipped, examined.
Yeah.
You never take up room in somebody's brain without very, very careful anticipation. No, with a song like Boatman, let me see. What have I got here? Hearts were exploding in violence as we drifted south in the bay, and the gray up above and the gray down below left us with nothing to say. So we drifted along in the silence till the tickle of life trickled in. And the rhythm began in the hiss of the sand. We were catching fire again. Boatman, I am a river. I am a mountain to the sea. Oh, boatman, taker and giver, can you be led? And can I forever run? So you have to think about when you're writing, it's the chorus, for example. Oh, boatman, I am a river. I am a mountain to the sea. Oh, boatman, taker and giver, can you deliver for me? And can I forever run free? Choruses need to be broad, need to be familiar, need to be ahs and ees, and need to tumble and wash over you. And then you get to the detail of the verse. We finally caught up with the legend. We were walking side by side. We worked out a plan to go hand in hand, but the long trail wasn't that wide.
I love that.
Yeah. I loved it when I wrote it. The water around us was freezing. We laughed and we threw ourselves in.
Love that.
And although we were old, the sting of that cold pumped up that feeling. Here it is again. Oh, boatman. Yeah. And so, by the way, there are other people. Robbie Robinson, when he writes The Night They Drove Old Dixie Down.
Yes.
And you have the night they drove old Dixie down. And I tell my students all the time, remember, a great song doesn't make you sound good. It makes your audience sound good when they're singing with you.
Yes. Yeah. I'm usually, Livingston, I'm usually the guy that sings way too loud.
Yeah.
And I get everyone around me, especially my wife, saying, hey, can you bring it down a little bit? You are so generous with your time, and I want to wrap this up, but I want to share a recollection with you. I remember being at Emerson College in 1988.
Yeah.
And a wonderful song came on the radio called City Lights.
Yeah.
You and James, and there's the video, and boy, you both look so young.
Were we young.
Yeah. So two questions.
He was five, I was three. Boy, yeah. We were young.
Well, there's a difference in hair length.
Yeah, well, you think? Yeah.
But two questions that I've just wanted to ask. One, how did that song come to be? Were you surprised at how popular it became? And then the other question is, in the video, why is James not playing the guitar and you are?
I'm playing the guitar because I played the guitar on the song. James just sang it. That's okay. James taught me how to play the guitar, and so that was a good instructor to have. So I could cover that part. The song was written by a friend of mine named Pat Alger, who's a wonderful songwriter. And again, a good pop song, tuneful, good chorus, city lights, finding it right. But when you hear that chorus, important to think about the tone when you're writing a song. City lights, finding her eyes, spinning out like Christmas lights under California sky. A lot of ahs there. When the sun goes down and those dreams begin to fade, she's got those city lights, ba-da-da. That's easy to sing. So when somebody's singing along, Greg, when you're singing along, it makes not me sound good, it makes you sound good. And when you sound good, sing well, guess what? You like yourself. And when you feel good about yourself and you leave my concert, then you come back again so you can feel good about yourself again. It is always about your audience. So for me to write songs without an audience to take them to, I'm not terribly interested.
Yeah. The harmony in City Lights.
Yeah.
Love it. It is just I'm about harmony. I don't know why. I love harmony. In fact, I know that you are still, according to what I've seen, you're still very close to Carly Simon.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And you two sang Best Friends.
Oh, forget about it. Beautiful song.
You know, I played on my Alexa, which is sitting right over there. Before I was talking to you, I said, play Livingston Taylor. And that song came on.
Yeah.
And I love it. And your harmonies in there. Mm. James and Carly had a magical sound.
Well, they had a magical sound musically, regretfully a little less magic, I think, ultimately in the marriage, but
I know.
That happens too.
That does.
But make no mistake, James is wonderful to sing with. He's a truly great player.
Yeah, yeah. How is he doing, if I can ask, about as I was asking you, you're off stage, you're not performing.
We were just talking the other night, and he canceled a huge quantity of work. But it's not only James, it's a full band. It's all the promoters, it's the managers, the agents. This is very, very difficult to stop work because Jeepers, Greg, it ain't just about me. It's about all the people who are employed as the result of James and I going out and playing.
Yeah.
So I am very big on cranking up the world again.
Yeah.
And people ask if I'm scared to travel, if I'm scared to be in groups. And the answer is that yes, I have concern and fear. But it is okay to be scared and move forward.
Yeah. You have a song, one of my favorite songs, and I'm thinking in the context of this pandemic, I kind of went back and forth thinking, is this appropriate or not? But it literally puts a smile on my face, and I know it does with your fans. And if people really listen to it, I think we could all use a smile. And that is the song, Life is Good. Can you share that with
sure. our viewers? We'll wind up with this one. How's that?
Yeah.
I want to make sure to get a little of my fingering in the shot in case somebody wants to steal something. Oh. Life is good. Spring is in the air. You got $2 in your pocket, a little bit of Brill cream in your hair. Oh, life is good when you're proud of what you do. Give your all to others, and it all comes back to you. Some guys are handsome, make friends all the time, always got a buddy, and they always feel fine. Others take the back seat, watch the world go by. Living life alone, quietly and shy. But when love strikes, those fires start to burn. Lonely years melt away. Finally, it's your turn, and you say, life is good. Winter's cold and cold. Love is forever, and it never will grow old. Oh, life is good, and you're proud of what you do. Now give your all to others. Come on now, try. Listen very closely to every laugh and sigh. Maybe there's a reason for all we do, giving your all. Others and it all comes back.
I am the luckiest son of a bitch around.
Oh, Greg, it's been so nice to speak with you.
You know, Livingston, it is truly a pleasure. I am so grateful that you took the time to play, to talk, to share. You are somebody that I wanted to hear from. I have received more than I thought I could just by talking to you about the world around us and your take on it. I am truly grateful.
I'm delighted. It's great to spend time with you. See you soon, Greg.
Thank you, Livingston. Bye.
Green with bits of blue, but it's all